So welcome to Kiel, everyone. We are on Germany's north coast for Kieler Woche, the famous sailing festival. Kiel Week is how you'd say it in English. Huge gathering of tall ships and yachts and boats of all different shapes and sizes for a week-long festival. What we've come in search of, though, is, and this is one of those classic business presentation phrases, synergies. Now, what we're basically talking about here is how something like a sport, sailing, and business technology can come together and actually do something for each other. Have a look at this. This is what we found.
Think Germany, and you don't necessarily think sailing. But then it has mounted America's Cup, World and Olympic campaigns, and it does host one of the world's biggest sailing events. And that event, Kieler Woche on the Baltic Sea off Kiel, shows there is plenty of interest.
Since we founded the sailing team, there are lots of sailors. They ask us, how can we be a member of the team? We want to get these clothes, we want to have the stickers in the sail, we want to be part of the national sailing team, and how can we do that?
But to increase numbers and hopefully success, Sailing Team Germany's had to think big. That means heavyweight German corporates, Audi and software group SAP, sponsors which, for sure, get their name on the boat, but contribute much more than just money.
In the past, it was always qualitative things. They discussed with their coaches afterwards, but it was like, for me, it felt like, and I think I have seen. So it's now really about fact-based coaching and training. The coaches have on their boat the information about what the sailors do, the performance they have, and the wind that is out there. And they have audio tools as well to talk to them and give them feedback and ask what they think when they do stuff. So that's really professionalizing the entire training.
SAP's idea is to complement a sailor's sporting ability with cold, hard facts and data. This is what the wind was doing, this is how the current was moving, and ultimately, this is what you were doing, right or wrong, in those conditions. According to SAP's co-CEO, it's a lot like business.
In sailing, at least in competition sailing, you need a strategy. And you form your strategy based on information from your surroundings and competitive moves. And then you need to execute the strategy, which is about getting a team to understand the strategy and be perfect at what they do, not individually, but as a team.
And the client seems pretty pleased too.
Since people sail, and no other animal does that really, thousands of years, it's always been about technology. And with the America's Cup, they always try to optimize the boats. What we're using increasingly now is information technology to mine, digest, and make sense of all the information we have available. That's fairly new.
Now, you saw there in that interview a quick word with Jim Snabe. He is one of the co-CEOs of SAP, the big business software company. Big international company it is, but with its roots in Germany. And it's his experience as a German businessman which we really wanted to tap into, especially with what's going on these days, not just in Germany, but right across the Eurozone with problems of debt, but more importantly, unemployment and sluggish growth. Here's the chat we had with him.
A question I like to start with these interviews in these sorts of times is, how's business?
I think you're right. You know, we talk about the current situation, but we actually had uncertain times for 3 or 4 years. And I think that's the new norm. It's the new normal. I don't think we will return to maybe we'll have better conditions and more growth, but I don't think we'll have the uncertainties go away.
So this has been a game changer, this whole last 3 years throughout Europe? You think it's actually changed the whole economic business landscape?
Most of all, I see companies getting used to the fact that you need to operate in a more real-time basis. You need to better and more actively understand what's going on in my business and then take more accurate and fast decisions and redirect your supply chains or whatever it is you do to the markets and where they are.
Tell me about business specifically in Germany, given that we can look to countries like Germany and France, which have survived this crisis better than most.
It's actually quite good in Germany. So while there's uncertainty in Europe, no doubt, and the southern part of Europe is in a level of crisis because of the debt situation, Germany is proving that you can be a European market and be very successful. There are a couple of reasons for that. First of all, they kept production, so they didn't outsource everything to other parts of the world. And they're very global in the approach, so companies in Germany are successful because they go global very early. And thirdly, and we've seen that at SAP, focus on innovation so that you can drive growth, not just efficiency.
So Germany's looked after itself well through those elements which you describe. Does that contribute to the idea that it's not a team player, or that it has managed to stay here and almost direct traffic throughout Europe when the other countries have not done well? Or am I being unfair there?
No, I think there is a lot of team play. If I look at how the politicians have been trying to argue, the euro is very important. Even if Germany is strong, Germany is standing up for the rest of Europe in many, many ways. And so I think there's a strong team play. And I actually believe that, you will see a strengthening of the level of team play in Europe going forward.
But it took so long for anyone to get a team idea. How do we work forward on this? There was a lot of, you should do this, you should do that, we don't want to do this. It seemed to be a very fractured team.
Yes, the problem is, like in a company, if you don't have a governance model that allows you to make the decisions, it's really hard to move things forward. And we have, in that sense, a very complicated situation in Europe with governmental structures. You have a Eurozone that's trying to cooperate, but with very little power, and uncertainty in some countries, even governmental issues on getting things done in a country. That's the complexity we're dealing with. And that's why it's a little bit slow.
Are you confident about the euro's future then? I think, again, when you look to where we are now and in the northern parts of Europe, yes, the euro is still strong, but there is still fear about the likes of Greece exiting the euro, and I wonder about the knock-on effect of that.
Well, I would argue that what we have is a debt crisis, because some countries have been spending more than they are earning. It's not a euro crisis. The euro is strong.
We've got an employment crisis, and we've got growth down all over the continent.
Yes.
This is, in fact, I think possibly the biggest story now is the unemployment and the lack of growth.
I agree. That is, for me, a much bigger issue. And so we've been focused on the euro conversation for a long time. But I don't think we can accept in Europe to have 40-50% unemployment, in particular not among young people. And young, well-educated people need to add value to Europe. And we need to, and we need to take responsibility as business leaders to bring these people into jobs. We need innovation, and innovation comes from young minds. And so it's a very big problem that we have, this unemployment.
Well, this leads me nicely to something which I hope you can explain for me and for our viewers, something I've been reading about, and forgive my pronunciation here, but Mittelstand, the idea of these smaller, medium-sized companies, which, when you look at it now, are possibly the reason why Germany has survived better. It seems to have good, strong, and when you talk about innovation and young people, apprenticeships, bringing people up through the ranks, good succession plans, so that you're not just found wanting in a crisis. Has that been a big part of Germany's success?
It has. I think you're on to a very, very important point. So first of all, we often talk about the big companies. We're a global leader in business software, and it's easy to go to the large companies and see if we can solve the problems. We will have to take a big responsibility in this, and also in training people, which we do. But I believe that it's clear that the large companies can scale and without adding always people because of the size. And therefore, the unemployment problem needs to be solved through an effort where we support these small and medium-sized companies that have great ideas. We can give them global reach. And so this combination of small and large working together and not the large trying to take all the opportunity, I think is key to solve this problem.
Are you a product of that? Someone who started lower down in SAP and another co-CEO?
You know, I started as a trainee in the company 22 years ago. So I was trained on the product, and I worked myself in an organization that gave people and young people opportunity. And I think I'm where I am today because people gave me the opportunity. And we need to do the same now. So at SAP, we're pushing an educational program. We want to bring unemployed people into IT. We are missing a lot of IT skills in Europe. It doesn't make sense. One of the fastest growing industries in the world is technology. So we will be educating unemployed people, skilled people, of course, and then with this hope to solve two problems, the unemployment among young people and the availability of technologists.
Well, okay, that seems to me that might be quite key, training people and getting them the skills to get into the jobs. It's all well and good to educate. There are other parts in Europe, I think, and other parts of the world would focus a lot on getting people into education. But unless there's the jobs to come to and the skills to use in those jobs after the education's not much use in the end.
That's correct. But in IT, already today, we're missing 40,000 people.
In Germany or just...
In Germany alone. So, and the estimations, if you take IT alone, because of the high growth that this industry has, we'll be having a significant gap in availability of people which doesn't make sense if you look at how technology will be innovating many of the problems of the future. We have an unemployment situation. So we need to skill people because there's jobs for them in IT.
And why do you think there's that big gap in IT in particular?
I don't think we've been paying attention enough to the growth. You look at the global growth of technology, how mobile and in-memory computing and cloud computing are changing the way businesses are conducted and how we live and work. This is an opportunity for us to grab, and we have not seen early enough in the educational system the need for IT people.
Do the people want to get into that, do you think? Do you think you're going to find the numbers of people interested to actually get into this?
Yes, I think in particular among young people, they are very IT and technology oriented and interested. You know, they're the Nintendo generations that grew up with technology, where we had to learn it. And from that point of view, I'm very confident that we can interest enough people. We need to give them the opportunity to train them, and then I think there's jobs as well.
Now, it's more than just a happy coincidence that SAP's got itself involved in sailing, and Jim Snabe himself is a very keen sailor. I even got a chance to go for a sail with him. Have a look at some of these pictures out on what is called an Extreme 40 catamaran. These are absolute Formula One racing yachts. Squally conditions, it was cold, it was miserable, but absolutely exhilarating. And certainly Jim knew what he was doing on the helm of that yacht. And after we got in, a little bit wetter, we had another chat about SAP's involvement in sailing. So, Jim, we're back in from a pretty wild ride out there. Very, very hard conditions. And I was actually just going to ask you, you know, why SAP wants to get itself involved in sailing, but I think we've answered the question today. Right. It's quite something out there.
It is, and in many ways I feel sailing is like business, you know, and sailing, at least in competition sailing, you need a strategy. And you form your strategy based on information from your surroundings and competitive moves. And then you need to execute the strategy, which is about getting a team to understand the strategy and be perfect at what they do, not individually, but as a team.
Has it been a successful move for SAP? My first knowledge of SAP was when you sponsored the Team New Zealand America's Cup team about 10 years ago, and that was unfortunately quite a spectacular failure with a broken boat and an SAP logo all over it.
Right.
I mean, that type of thing doesn't put you off. You obviously come back into the sport and concentrate more on your home ground.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, we do it very differently now. We've actually taken a very new stand in sponsoring, which is not just about pouring money into something, but showcasing our technology. So, for instance, here at the Kieler Woche, we have our technology on all the races, which means we can, first of all, help the spectators understand what's going on out there at the water, which is very hard. They get real-time feed, you can analyze. And secondly, we help the sailors become better because we give them the data at night. In the evening, when they come back, they can analyze and see which strategy was the better one and what do I need to do tomorrow.
What about competition? I mean, the obvious name that comes to mind is Oracle, which is heavily involved with, it's the defender of the America's Cup and is in the same business as you.
Yeah, we've chosen, first of all, a very different strategy. Innovation orientation and putting our technology to play the software in action here. And secondly, we also go after more the breadth of this sport, not all about, you know, who's got the more money, but all about getting many sailors to enjoy the opportunity of technology to help them sail better.
Great stuff.
Very different.
Good. Yep, we had a great time there in Kiel, and a big thanks to SAP for all their cooperation. That's where we're going to leave you for this week, but if you want to get in touch with the show, here's how you do it. Twitter's the easiest way, through either myself at KamahlAJE or Al Jazeera's business editor at Abid Oliver Ali. Email's the two if you're not on Twitter. It's counting the cost at aljazeera.net. And while you're online, you can head to aljazeera.com/business and link onto the CTC page where we put all our episodes up in full for you to catch up on whenever you'd like. But that is it for this edition of Counting the Cost. I'm Kamahl Santamaria from the whole team. Thanks for joining us. The news on Al Jazeera is next.